it's okay to flee a massacre. In fact, it's advisable. And that sums up all the videos that have been shared here. Simply stating this in many, many ways, it's okay to flee a massacre. Because existence is a massacre. It is a perpetual massacre. It's a sacrificial endeavor. And it's okay to flee that, both long-term and short-term as well. And we continue to harp upon this because it should be a self-evident truth, right? It should be okay to flee a massacre, and yet nobody's fleeing it. So it's obviously we're confused. We're thinking that there's must be some profound reason not to flee it. And we're exposing the entire sacrificial belief system for what it is. And so as far as, I always say, keep advancing the narrative. Don't get caught up in any details. Don't get caught up in any discussions or details or anything like that, because literally we are trying to flee a massacre. And when one is fleeing a massacre, what questions need to be asked, really? You don't stop and say, wait a minute, let me, you know, think about this. No, you flee. So we're trying to get into that state of fleeing, but how do you flee existence, you see? That is the question. And we have received some very good advice on that in this world. Truth is where you find it. I mean, if something is giving great advice, then, you know, it's giving great advice. We don't have to be partial to anything just based on tradition or based on any other factors, familiarity. But if we find truth somewhere, then we should, you know, heed that advice. I tend to heed advice. I guess that's one attribute I'd say that I have, that is a very good attribute to have, is I listen to what others say, and I heed their advice if it is something that is seems to be worth following. Today I ate my first ghost pepper, Butjolokia. The Naga ghost pepper, that, you know, used to be the hottest pepper in the world. There are a few derivatives now that they've cultivated that are hotter. But I'm growing my own, and the first one that was ready is a small one. Probably wasn't as potent as others. But what I did was I followed the advice that I've gotten from quite a few people. And they said, chop it up very finely. Chop it up very finely, which I did. Being careful not to get any on my fingers, using a fork and a knife, chopping it up, dicing it. And then I poured lime juice on top of it. And then I ground some pink Himalayan crystal salt on it, really good salt. And then let that, stirred it up, and then let it marinate for just a little while. Let it sit there just a little while, several minutes. And then I ate just a little bit at a time, and had a sandwich too. And it went flawlessly. It was great. Best pepper I've ever eaten. It gave sort of a euphoric feeling, really. Through the whole body, it was this sort of this unusual euphoria. It was amazing. It wasn't too hot or anything like that. So I did it the right way, you see. Bit by bit, kind of in an intelligent way. Instead of just, you know, chomping on it, just chomp, 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 like you see on YouTube, these guys just eating a ghost pepper or a Trinidad scorpion or something really super hot, just eating the whole pod, chomp, 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 chomp. That is stupid. That is really stupid. And you get this intense pain in your stomach afterwards, suffering so bad, internally you suffer terrible. It's a trauma. They're traumatizing themselves. Whereas the way that I did it, there was no trauma at all. In fact, it was a fabulous experience, and got the flavor of everything. And like I said, for 2 hours, I had this euphoric reaction to it. It was really amazing. Didn't expect that at all. And I wasn't burned badly. And so there are ways to do things that are intelligent, and heeding the advice sometimes of those who know what they're talking about is the way to do it. So if we come across something that gives good advice, all you have to do is say, yeah, maybe that's advice worth following. Now, in my case, I was struggling in this world terribly. When I was young, I tried to teach, to give advice to people, and that had a very strong, severe backlash. And people didn't want to listen to what I had to say because they felt I was too young, and how could I know, how can someone so young know anything? It's ridiculous. They thought it was ridiculous and presumptuous and all of that. And, you know, just so many factors conspired to bring me down. And I was so down, I had to find out, how do I get back off the mat, you know? And so I kept looking for advice, good advice. And finally, I found something that was very, very helpful. I felt it was good advice. And that was in 1978, I came across the three-volume set called A Course in Miracles. Came across that. No one told me about it. I just stumbled across it in a bookstore. And I felt that whoever wrote this was giving very good advice. So I started to listen to the advice. I didn't always agree with it. We don't always follow advice, but I at least got enough of it. So I thought, okay, you know, this is helpful. And gradually, it was helpful. So I took a little bit of time, a little bit of time, a little bit of time. Just kept trying to, every day, take more and more and more. Like it was a ghost pepper. You know, you don't chomp the whole thing down. And I kind of studied it every day and every day and every day. And gradually, over the years and even the decades, I think it's been, this is like my 34th year, I believe, in October of this, well, no, it's already, I came across it in the summertime, so it's been 34 years now, 34 years. And I went away for it for quite some time because I wanted to just boil it all down to the essence of it. And sometimes the words can be too many words. I wanted to get away from the words. And now I've gone back and looking at the words, it seems to be aligned very, very much with what is being shared here. It's just for my own clarity when I'm sharing this, I read the course, A Course in Miracles, and it seems like, wow, you know, this is just exactly, you know, what's being shared here. It's very similar. So I feel it's good advice, really good advice, even though I'm less than overwhelmed by the success that A Course in Miracles has had as far as the teachers that have come out in the world saying that they're teachers of the Course of A Course in Miracles, and, you know, saying they're enlightened or various things. I'm you know, less than thrilled by it. It seems to be substandard, at least from what I expected. I expected, you know, people would be like Sri Anandamaya Ma, would be, you know, would be truly enlightened, or like Ramana Maharshi. I really expected that, and I haven't seen that. So that's kind of it's a bit of a shock, but still, the advice in there, I believe, is extremely good, extremely very, very good advice. If you take it to heart, you'll be able to flee the massacre, and ultimately, that's a very sane thing to do. To not flee a massacre is a very insane thing to do. And we've here in these videos, we have exposed just the madness behind the desire to not flee. We've really brought it to light. And it's very simple. It's very simple. And it's worth repeating over and over. But for some reason, it's also very difficult. Because of the familiarity we have with what we've taught ourselves. We've learned everything in existence. We've learned and learned and learned and overlearned and overlearned. And we've so much overlearned it that we're so familiar with it that we feel that, be it ever so humble, there's no place like home, and that it somehow we think we have a way to make lies true. And so we feel we might as well stick with what we're familiar with. But the point of great advice in this world is to tell you that the impossible will never happen. Doesn't matter how long we stick with it. That's basically the entire teaching. It doesn't matter how long we stick with it, how much we believe in it, how much faith we have in it, doesn't matter what kind of sacrifices take place, none of that matters. The impossible will always be impossible. That's the entirety of the teaching. And yet we have so much trouble with that because the entire premise of existence is that the impossible will become possible, that there's a way to do it. And so the crossroads is simply that. Is there a way to do it, or is there not a way to do it? And the answer is there is not a way to do it. That is the answer. And you know, for some, they need to maybe take that on faith somewhat. I've been able to spend the time to work it all through and literally see why it can never work. But still, there seems to be some belief and faith still there. Because we feel it's an unanswered question, but it's not really. It's not, because we were not created with the power capacity to make lies true. We were not, and so we don't have it. Reality doesn't change. The parameters of reality do not change. They're not changeable. Reality's not changeable. And so we're simply insisting that we can develop that ability, and we cannot. We cannot. The whole existence is all about development, isn't it? It's about sacrifice and development. We're continuously, everything, there's a continual massacre happening continuously. And there's never a moment in existence that a massacre is not taking place on this planet. There are trillions of animated forms dying every second on this planet, from the microorganisms, you know, all the way up through and through everything on this planet, the algae, the plants, you name it, trillions of animated forms in some way, either plants aren't so animated, but they do, there's animation going on and they're growing, etc. All of that is being massacred constantly. Trillions and trillions of these forms are being massacred every second, really, every second. And all the everything that's not, doesn't seem to be animate, like stones and dirt and all that, also is being massacred. It's being worn down constantly. Everything is disintegrating, right, into dust. And yet so there's that constantly massacre, constantly happening. And there's also the constant effort to develop higher and higher forms, more and more forms, more and more of existence. And we're trying to develop a power, a capability. And we don't realize quite what that is. We just feel this, like there's a manifest destiny involved with existence. And we feel also that it somehow we're moving toward a fait accompli, that there's something that is definitely going to take place. And it's just a matter of when. We feel we're moving towards that. And we, as we progress and develop and evolve, we feel we're evolving towards something. We feel that all the universe is going towards some denouement of some sort, you know, some moment where there a catalytic agent will somehow bring about something that we have aimed for from the very beginning. And what that is we believe that somehow a lie will be catalyzed into truth. A hypothetical will be catalyzed into an actual. Okay? Because existence is just a hypothetical. We believe that that will take place. So we feel like compelled to continue our march through history, through all the winding trail and the ups and the downs. And it's like a death march. You know, we continue our death march along through the path of existence. And we feel compelled to do so. Like we have some kind of blinders on, you know, and we're just like draft animals going along. And every time we want to stray, something's whipping us, you know, and goading us to keep on going down this path. And even though something within us wants to rebel and say, no, 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 no. This is futile. This is a waste of time. This is meaningless. This is aimless. This is impossible. We still keep plodding along that path, you know. And all I'm saying is, hey, it's okay to get off that path. Get off that path. Choose a different causal agent. Now, there are lots of teaching in this world that says somehow we can overlay, you know, by being loving towards one another, being kind, loving to one another, somehow that will suffice. And the truth is that the whole point of the right advice is to realize that no exceptions can be made to truth whatsoever, none. You cannot see part of something as love part of something and leave out some other part, because it's then unholy, not whole. Reality is holy, meaning there's no parts left out whatsoever. In fact, there are no parts at all. It's all one. You can't fragment it into parts. It's not possible. There may be facets to it, but not parts. So what we're trying to do, what we think in existence as a spiritual path, is thinking that, well, we can forgive this or forgive that, you know, but not this or not that. The whole point of the teaching is you have to not make any exception whatsoever, not even the slightest. But how do you do that? How do you do that? And the truth of the matter is, that it's very important to hear this, is that you do it by choosing a different idea. Okay, by choosing a different idea. Choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator. Because the idea that we're following now, the death march, is we want to be a prime creator. That is the idea that we chose. We wanted to be greater than God. And so we need to just choose to not try and be greater than God, just to be what we really are, which is spirit, the prime created. And that will automatically give rise to an overlay that overlays all symbols, all hypotheticals. Overlays the hypotheticals entirely. All hypotheticals. And all hypotheticals are just simply what if the impossible could be accomplished. You know, all plausibility, all hypotheticals. It overlays it all equally, with no distinction whatsoever about any of its parts. And then experiencing that then totally reminds us of reality. Because that's exactly the way that reality is. And in reality is that which is. Not any process, not trying to establish self, it's that which is. So it's literally, we have to choose a new idea in order to succeed. You cannot do it by piecemeal kind of stitching together a garment of forgiveness, as it were, or stitching together a garment of loving thoughts towards others or something. It doesn't work that way. At best, that is simply a practicing. Okay, at best, it's just a practicing. So I never spend time trying to say, well, I need to be forgiving in this instance or loving in this instance or anything like that, because I understand that the goal is you have to choose a new idea, a new causal agent, which then gives rise to the unconditional love. That is what has to be done, and that will automatically, you'll see forgiveness everywhere without any exception. But the attempt to do it bit by bit is just an impossible grind. It'll just tie you up in knots. So if you're aiming to choose a new idea, your aim is accurate. Your aim is accurate. There is no attempt on my part to start a new religious dogma, so to speak, because it's only aiming at that, you know, that one thing, or choose a new idea. That's it. That's the cure. So, and everybody has their own kind of path, you know, to kind of work in that direction. But we don't want to, I certainly don't want to let anyone think that somehow they're supposed to, bit by bit by bit by bit, you know, accumulate some sort of resume of forgiveness, a resume of loving thoughts, or anything like that. That is a waste of time. The most loving thing you can possibly do is to pursue the truth. And then set yourself free, choose a new idea, and let everyone else know that this is doable. This is the way, this is doable. And that's the most loving thing and you could possibly do. And it's the only truly loving thing you can do, because anything else is leaving exclusion, which will teach a mixed message and does not remind us of reality at all. Now, we believe that having, you know, unconditional love would be an incredible burden on our shoulders. Why? Because we experience making exceptions as an incredible burden. Super difficult. It's like we're carrying a load and it's shifting all the time, and we can't get the weight distributed properly, and we're stumbling under the weight of this load, you know, thinking, okay, well, who do I forgive? How much do I forgive? What's the loving thought? I don't really understand what love is, or, you know, how can I be loving in this situation? Now, what, did I leave someone else out? And you just go through this crazy, you know, stress. I mean, I remember trying to get there in that way, and it just completely wiped me out, devastated me. That's the ego's plan, because it doesn't work. But the fact is that by including all, by overlaying everything equally, there's no burden at all, because there's no shifting weight. There's no change. There's nothing you need to accommodate. You're not going to stumble across something that's different. It's completely effortless. No effort at all is involved. Whereas making exceptions and exclusion involves infinite effort. It is simply a nightmare. So, like when I sort of fell away from the truth and decided to go with the world's advice, which I didn't want to do, but the pressure, I wanted to try and help people, and people simply couldn't relate to what I was saying. So I thought, well, I guess all I can do is try and see it their way and see if I can find some way to help them, you know, that way. What happened again is I found myself trying to mentally stitch everything together, all these pieces together, forgive here, forgive there, and then every situation became way too complex. Like in social situations, I'd be seeing every kind of thing that's going on and thinking, okay, what do I need to do here, there to be loving and not be harsh and be forgiving and have the right attitude here, and everything's like a kaleidoscope, constantly changing, and it's just totally overwhelming. The mind is just racing, trying to figure out everything. That's not the way at all. That's the way that doesn't work. What you do is you choose a new idea. The overlay of unconditional love is the effect of that idea, requires no maintenance, no effort on your part, and it automatically forgives and loves everything. There's nothing to forgive, because everything is overlaid with this flawless, perfect distribution. Nothing has more, nothing has less. There is no change taking place. Everything is peaceful. Nothing can suffer. Unconditional love cannot suffer any loss at all. It's invulnerable. All of that is already there perfectly. So that is the goal. The goal is to choose a new idea. A Course in Miracles says, choose once again. You need to make another choice. That's what it's talking about. You need to make that choice. The other stuff, it's just trying to build another religion, which I absolutely am not interested in the slightest bit. Having fallen into the swamp of this world with all its religions, it's just like an endless swamp, because none of them get to the point, really. You know, the point is very simple. Choose a new idea. That's it. Flee the massacre, you know. You do that by choosing a new idea. It's the only way. It's the only way to do it. But you can certainly move in that direction, which some of the religious teachings do help a little bit move. But the essence of it needs to be more clearly spelled out, because it seems like everybody in the world is trying to stitch together this garment, you know. And it's all tattered, and people get bogged down, they get slowed down, they just think, wow, I can't do it, it's too complicated, you know. Was I loving in this interaction or not? You know, they're all obsessed with it. I remember how obsessed I was with that. Was I loving here? Could I have been more loving? Could I have said something nicer? Did I cause someone to feel fear? Was it my fault, their fault? Everything becomes a psychodrama. We don't need any psychodrama. Don't evaluate yourself on that level. Evaluate yourself simply, are you going towards choosing a new idea? That's it. If you are, then what you're doing is spot on. And if you're not, what you're doing is just, you're going to end up, you know, enmeshed in psychodramas, which is not helpful at all. Are you moving towards choosing a new idea? Which means, again, everything equally, no exceptions at all to it. You're not holding anything apart from unconditional love. Can't. Because unconditional love sees all hypothetical as the same, equally futile. There is simply no reason whatsoever to draw distinctions or judgments between differing attempts to accomplish the impossible. They're all equally futile. And unconditional love knows that. It just spreads out equally. It doesn't even spread out. It arises equally everywhere at the same time. It's not like a tsunami of love is going to sweep through you. It's not like that at all. It's that simultaneously it will seem as if the entire universe everywhere simultaneously, all time, all space, all circumstances and situations, this gentle, perfectly stable, blissful, peaceful, unconditional love simply like blossoms everywhere. Like that. The whole universe has suddenly blossomed with it. Gently. And that includes where you are too. Includes everything. Nothing's excluded. So there is no process of it at all. There's no tidal, there's no tsunami sweeping along, like, here comes the wave of unconditional love, like that. It's not an energetic type of thing. It's a simultaneous blossoming everywhere. And you have to be willing to allow that to happen. No exclusions, because all attempts to accomplish the impossible are equally futile. So all you're doing is just saying, yeah, nothing works as far as transmuting a hypothetical into reality. Nothing works. That's all you're saying. You're not saying this has a better chance of working than that. You know, no, it's all equally null and void, nil, nothing. No success, no possibility of success, no prospects at all. Existence has no prospects at all. And so the forgiving thing to do is to forgive all of it. Why would you hold out something and say, wait a minute, this has some possibility of succeeding, when in fact it doesn't? So the loving thing to do is allow unconditional love to arise, to blossom everywhere in the universe simultaneously. That's what salvation really is. You allow the entire universe to be saved. And of course, that includes you. It includes what you think you are, what you hypothetically believe you are. It includes the entire belief system, including everything you believe yourself to be. The fact is, what we are isn't really hypothetical at all. It's real. It already is. But we believe that we're something else, or becoming something else. So all that becoming, all that belief, all of that which constitutes the universe simultaneously blossoms. And it's not a traumatic event for you, because there's no buffeting, there's no wind, there's no energy moving at all. No. Not at all. Because it's everywhere simultaneously. Totally gently. Comes in more gentle than the subtlest breeze or the subtlest fog, or, you know, like a cat, so gentle walking. No, it's super, super, super gentle. And the whole entire universe is that way. It includes everything. So everybody is saved. Everything. The entire universe is safe. That is the only salvation there is. It's not like you're saving a person here on planet Earth or something. No. You're saving the entire universe, because the entire universe is what we have made. The entire universe is the belief system that we're believing in. It is the hypothetical. And there are no circumstances taking place in the universe, or ever will take place, that can make the transmute this hypothetical into an actual, what is real? None, none, none. So we're working towards this different model of enlightenment, okay? Than different than we're used to. We're used to thinking that there's somebody who has reached enlightenment or something. Whatever it is we were used to, we're looking at a slightly different model, or simply clarifying models that may be accurate but could stand some clarification, or re-emphasizing it. If it's already clear, we're re-emphasizing it. Entire universe, simultaneously unconditional love blossoms everywhere. And that blossoming is a perpetual blossoming. It's a perpetual blossoming. It's not the kind of blossoming we're used to, where the flower bud opens and blossoms and then it you know, gets old, withers and dies. No, it's a perpetual blossoming. Or another way of putting it is that it blossoms simultaneously everywhere. And then the perfume is released, and this release of this perfume is continuous. No end to it. Continuous, and the blossoms don't fade. And this perfume is continuously being emitted by all these blossoms. The entire universe is emitting this perfume now. Unconditional love, all the blossoms, continuously emitting this divine perfume, this rasa, this nectar, as it were. The whole universe is not somebody separate from this that's experiencing it. It's the whole universe is experiencing it. Because each one of us is literally experiencing a different universe. Okay? You might wonder, well, if the whole universe is enlightened, how come we don't all feel it? Well, we do feel it, but we're all experiencing a different universe, and our belief system, we have free will, we can continue to believe that our universe is unenlightened. So each of us, you know, there's 7 billion people on the planet, on this planet Earth, and really there are 7 billion different planet Earths, but there are also 7 billion different universes too, okay? Let's expand it. Let's be real about this. And so the enlightenment of your universe doesn't mean the enlightenment of someone else's universe. However, the principle is exactly the same. And so others can pick up on it and say, whoa, okay, this is what I need to do to my universe. I can't liberate myself from my universe. I have to liberate the entire universe altogether. And it's easily done. Just choose a new idea. Choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator. That gives rise to unconditional love, that which is not trying to change anything. And that blooms in the entire universe, past, present, future, all circumstances, the entire hypothetical belief system blooms everywhere simultaneously and then continuously emits this divine fragrance. That is what you have to look forward to in your universe, and everybody will have the same experience in their universe, because it's all hypothetical. All universes that we're seeing are hypothetical, so the remedy is exactly the same, and that the realization, the hypothetical, can never be catalyzed or transmuted into reality. Can never do that. And so, and all of these universes arose from the idea of trying to be prime creator, which can never happen. And the remedy is the same, to choose a new idea. That's the remedy for all universes that arise. The reality is not a universe. Okay, it's not a dance of form and energy and sacrifice and change and all that stuff. Not at all. We don't need to worry about that. It's essence, it's idea, it's essence. It doesn't even require space or time at all. But that's not important right now. What's important is this: to choose a new idea and to experience this blossoming of the entire universe, which can't help but put a smile on our face. Now, how am I able to say this if I haven't done it? Because I have always had precognition. I've always been able to see ahead somehow. So what I'm really doing right now is just viewing ahead. I'm viewing my own future and seeing what it's going, what it was it like, and then seeing that, and then reporting back in time and space, what is it like? So somehow I'm able to see what my universe is going to be like, and it's going to be simply all flowers blossoming, the blossoming of unconditional love everywhere, and then the emittance of this continual fragrance, which is a metaphor for maybe bliss or peace or something that is, you know, just divinely satisfying. So I can get a little bit of a smile right now, just sort of pulling that, and how is it going to be? And you can't help but smile. You have to be quite happy that your entire universe has been saved, the whole thing, all together, not separately. There was no process that first this part, and there were no dominoes falling, okay? First this part, and then that part, and then that part. There's no dominoes. It's not a domino effect. It's all at once, all together. And people have sort of misinterpreted this and thinking that we all need to save our universes together. No, that's not true. That is not true. We all need to ascend together or something. No, that's not true. Each one of us has our own universe in hypothetical. We all have our own hypothetical universe. And it's up to us to allow that our hypothetical universe to be saved. Nobody can do it for us, because they have a different universe. Your universe belongs to you. No, nobody can, you know, intrude upon it, really. You know, and you're the ruler of that hypothetical universe. And all you have to do is allow the totality of it to be saved. It's the only way it can be saved, all together. Let it be overlaid. Let the entire universe be overlaid with this blossoming everywhere. And then when you decide to do it is up to you. Each one will decide, you know, when they feel ready to do that. But it is not like you need to be part of some group, and the group has to do it both at the same time, or else it'll mess everything up. That is a misunderstanding. That's like saying we're thinking we all live in the same universe, and the only way to save it is if we all get enlightened at the same time, and the overlay would happen to all of us at the same time. That's a misunderstanding. We don't all live in the same universe. We all live in different universes, different hypotheticals, different perspective on it, different perception of it, all different. And what's important is not that each one of these different universes are enlightened at the same time. What's important is your universe, all of it, is enlightened at the same time, is freed at the same time, is overlaid at the same time. No domino, so there's no question of what went first, you know, what part of your universe got enlightened first. No such thing. It all was enlightened simultaneously. So there wasn't any first, because the ego is going to ask you that. Well, who, what part went first? And the ego then wants to get involved in a dialectic, you know, discussion of why did this go first and why was that second, and you know, all this nonsense. Because it can't believe it believes in process, where there's no such thing as process in reality. Everything is, and yet in this massacre we've been engaging in, trying to build up this power of destructivity over reality, it's all a process, isn't it? All we see is process. All we see is process. We believe. There really is no process at all taking place, but we believe that there is a process taking place. I don't know why this has frozen up on me here. Doesn't seem to be recording the audio at this point. The whole computer seems to have frozen up, actually. Okay. There you go. Okay, is it unfrozen now? It all froze up. I don't know if you heard anything there. I kind of stopped talking. I hope the computer does not crash, but anyway. Okay, we're back. No process. There's no process, really. There's only hypothetical, plausible process. That's where, again, it's all hypothetical. It's all plausible. It's simply based on our belief, and we can believe anything we want to. We believe there's a process taking place, so we think, we believe we see it. But actually, nothing's taking place. Nothing at all is taking place. So each one of us has to look forward to the enlightenment of our universe. all simultaneously. And people then will ask, you know, whoa, what happened to you? You know, you seem like released from all burdens, you know. You seem so happy. And then you'll, you know, you'll be able to say what happened. We have this belief that we're all experiencing the same universe. It's not true. It's not true at all. Everybody has a unique viewpoint of the universe, their own universe. It's all in their mind, you know. The universe isn't out there, it's in here. It's in the mind. It's in our perception, it's in our memories. It's everything. Everyone has a different universe. You know that's true. No two interpret things the same way. What's going on in existence as far as how they believe in it. You know, the beliefs and how it's all configured and everything. It seems all, it's different. Even though it's all the same, equally futile, it's all equally hypothetical. It's all equally hypothetical. It's all the attempt to accomplish the impossible. It comes from the same idea, the idea of trying to be prime creator. But that idea gives rise to all this fragmentation. Okay, so each one of us has our own universe. So if we can start thinking of it that way, it doesn't necessarily dawn on you right away, because I've heard this over and over, and it never really dawned on me until just right now. I just kind of said, oh, so that's what's being said. It's not, what tripped me up was, they said everyone has their own world, and I couldn't relate to that, because that is not the truth. Everyone has their own universe, not just a world. Because I always thought, well, if everyone has their own world, but what about the rest of the universe? How about that? Is that all the same to us? It's not. We all have our own universe. Okay. And yet what we have the power, we have the capability to free our own universe, all of it, simultaneously. So there's no judgment of what part is better, which is more worthy, what's less worthy. Any of that judgment, we don't need any judgment whatsoever, except that the entirety of it is equally futile. The aim, the goal, all of this will never be realized. So nothing is contributing to realization of making the hypothetical real. Nothing is contributing. Nothing has ever contributed. Nothing has ever contributed more or less. It's all been zero. So by what basis would we withhold salvation from our universe? By what basis would we say, no, I don't want everything, my universe, to be simultaneously enlightened. I want something to go first, I want something else to go second, and I have something, you know. On what basis would we believe that? If everything, nothing has contributed at all to the realization of the goal. Zero contribution. On what basis would we judge, again, what should go first and what should go second? See, that way you say, hey, why don't we all just, let's just have it all be simultaneous, and bingo, you know, there you go. You've just realized it. That's the answer. That's the final judgment, is that no judgment is necessary. We're all going to, you know, do this together. You know, your universe, my universe, your universe, it's all going to celebrate together, all together. No first or second. It's not some part of your universe was going to go first and get it first, be enlightened first, and the rest of your universe is going to follow along with that. No, like, not there's going to be some teacher in your universe that's going to teach the rest of your universe how to be enlightened. It's not like that at all. It all goes simultaneously. It's a simultaneous. Nothing excluded. Nothing excluded. So when it comes to advice, I feel this advice is spot on. It's absolutely spot on. Just one second here. Hold on. Yep. All right. So we continue on with this. And if you can hear this, and even if you say, I'm not sure, I don't know, if you can at least hear what's being said, you will have taken a gigantic step, moved so much closer to it. Because like I said, I didn't initially get this. I really did not. In any teaching, anything you're following, usually you're going to get some of it and not all of it. Some of it's going to say, I don't know about that. That's perfectly fine. It's your universe. You're in charge of your universe, and you decide for your universe what's going to take place there. What I'm saying is what really works. You know, you're going to try all sorts of stuff in your universe. Definitely are. I've tried all sorts of stuff in my universe. Hasn't worked. Hasn't worked. But now, so now I'm seeing from what doesn't work, I'm seeing, now I see what must work. I see it. Now I can realize, this is what must work. And so some point you will see that also, what must work, you know, in your universe. But until that point, you're going to try all sorts of stuff and then evaluate it. Maybe try to join universes together. A lot of people are trying to do that. Let me join my universe with your universe. It doesn't work. It doesn't work because they're still two different universes just kind of hanging out together, but they're still two different universes. Perception can never really join. Cannot. It cannot. Just freezing up again. Okay. Perception is always variable. So it's futile to try and join your universe with someone else's. You know, let's merge our universes. It's not possible. You cannot merge universes. You cannot merge perceptions. It cannot be merged. So the way is, again, to allow your universe to be enlightened simultaneously, all of it enlightened together, one. And I feel like I'm moving towards allowing that to happen. I'm in charge of my universe. I'm seeing, okay. I give permission for that to happen to my universe. Now, your universe, you're in charge. I can do nothing in your universe. I can appear in your universe, but you're in charge of your universe. I can't enlighten your universe. Nobody can. You have the free will, your spirit, your free will, and you have the right and ability and the will and the power to imagine, to believe, and pursue a hypothetical. You have the right to do it. You have the perfect freedom to do that. Nobody can step on your freedom. It's impossible. So I can appear in your universe, but it will be your perception of me in your universe. It won't be what I really am, but your perception of it. What we are is beyond perception. And when you allow the totality of your universe to be simultaneously enlightened, overlaid by unconditional love, then you will remember, you will have a reflection of what you really are. You will then start being reconciled to what you really are. And you'll realize you're not an object of perception. Perception can never know what you are. Perception cannot know reality. Reality it's directly experienced. It has nothing to do with perception. So as long as we are in the hypothetical, which uses perception, everyone has their own universe and will perceive everyone else in their universe as, you know, be a perception, not as they truly are. Okay. So we're really getting somewhere, and it started out by saying you need to flee the massacre, which is existence as a massacre. You have to flee it, meaning make haste in your considerations. Again, you are the absolute ruler of your universe. You're in charge, and you keep wondering, how come I cannot configure it the way I want to if you're in charge? Well, you're in charge. What you're trying to do is you're trying to use the universe, your universe, to change reality, and that can never happen. And so, because that's the purpose of your universe, the universe acts in crazy ways, and it seems to be out of your control, because the whole purpose is it's supposed to be more powerful than you are. Okay? It's supposed to be greater than you are. The idea that effect can be greater than cause. Spirit wants to be greater than prime creator, effect greater than cause. So you give rise to this hypothetical, and its purpose is to be greater than what gave rise to it. So the universe seems to be in control of you. Your universe seems to be controlling you. Effect controlling cause, greater than cause. That's its purpose. And again, you can't change the purpose of a cause, of an idea. You can only choose a new idea which has a different purpose. So we keep trying to arrange our universe in some way. That's futile. That's futile. It will always be the way that it is, a Frankenstein monster for you. Always. No matter how you try to, you know, decorate it and dress it up, etc., it will always continually engage in massacre. Always. But if you choose a new idea, then your universe will be overlaid by this unconditional love. Unconditional love, in order to show what it is, it needs to overlay a hypothetical. So it's not like the universe disappears. It doesn't disappear. It is overlaid. It's a different thing than disappearing. It does not disappear. But it is the arising, simultaneously, immediate, instantaneous arising of a hypothetical that is overlaid. The hypothetical, what if I did not try to change reality? See? Automatically knows that it is the remedy for the idea of trying to change reality. It's understood. And so it's not like everything disappears and you're in some void of nothing. No. Your universe is still there, and yet it's overlaid. It's the entire universe suddenly blossoms and is giving off this divine scent. And it's like peace comes to the entire universe, and there's no more massacre in your universe taking place. Everything simply is exactly as it is in that moment. And it is, the blossoming occurs everywhere. There's massacre ends. The massacre ends. And instead you see just a total celebration. The totality of it, not parts of it, the entire universe as one. Celebration as being freed, all as one, you see. And that's hard for us to wrap our conceptual mind around, definitely is. But we can get close to it. We can close in on this, which is what we're doing here. We can close in on it. And we don't need to try and think about it too much. Not necessary. Just the basics are all that's important. As you flee a massacre, all you need to know is the basics. What direction do I need to go in? How fast do I need to run? Okay, you get that? Good, that's it. Then you run as fast as you can in the right direction. That's it. And again, like eating that ghost pepper, it only took me like 10 minutes to eat half a ghost pepper. It took me 10 minutes, I'll say. Well, if you'd like chomp down, maybe you'd eat it in like, you know, 30 seconds or something, if you just chomped on it. But 10 minutes isn't very long. It was fast, but I did it in the right way, which is, you see everything very clearly first. And that's what really enables you to make the right decision. If you just chomp down on it without seeing clearly, you're going to react. You're going to have, it's trauma time. So if you make the right considerations, which is what we're doing here, it's not trauma time, it's not traumatic. I don't feel making this decision would be a traumatic one, because again, it's all at once, you see. There is no trauma anywhere. There's no first or last, more deserving, less deserving. Everything equally did not contribute anything to the goal. Reaching the goal contributed nothing. But that's, see, this is a fact that is true in all universes, all your universes. There's nothing in your universe that contributed the slightest bit to the success of your goal, which is to transmute the hypothetical into a reality. Nothing in anyone's universe has helped in the slightest bit. That is a fact, transuniversal fact, good for all universes. And the fact that choosing a new idea is a transuniversal fact, good, applicable to all universes. And the fact that the unconditional love arises from choosing a new idea and overlays everything in your universe simultaneously, that also is a transuniversal fact, true in all universes. All right. So in just looking at this, you'll say, it's not so difficult. It's not so mythical. It's not so weird. It's not too hot. It's not too tough to swallow this. It's pretty easy. I was terrified of that ghost pepper. I really was, because they said, you look at these YouTube videos and people are just absolutely being devastated, traumatized by them. And I said, wow, there must be some way to eat it that's not so traumatic, isn't there, you know? But I was scared, really. But I took just a tiny bit first at a time, just a tiny bit, a little bit more. And by the end, I was taking a lot at the same time, but I realized, hey, it's not traumatic. It's not so bad. But, at first I was careful. And that's the way I am. I'm kind of very, very careful at first, but intelligently, a little bit more, and then say, okay, I can see it's not so bad at all. And that's the spiritual path. You can be like that as you evaluate what to do with your universe. You evaluate it. You can gradually increase your listening to this idea, advice of choose a different idea, set your entire universe free simultaneously. Overlay, allow the overlay to take place simultaneously. No trauma. There's no trauma there. Zero trauma, zero effort. No effort to maintain it, completely gentle. You start hearing this and you say, wow, it's not as traumatic as I thought. In fact, it's probably not traumatic at all. And as that dawns upon you more and more, then you'll get closer and closer to it as you realize it's not traumatic at all. No trauma. The trauma is involved in trying to maintain the universe as it is now, your universe. It's nothing but trauma, actually. Nothing but trauma. Totally unwieldy. No matter what you do, it just doesn't work. And you know it. You know it. All right. This has been a pretty amazing video. It's getting kind of dark out here now. Again, the effort to teach is the greatest help there is, because you end up extending your clarity great deeper than you would if you're just trying to not really help anyone else, because you want to come up with something that is truly helpful and worthwhile and worth the time of people to listen to. So in each video I make, I try to come up with something that justifies spending the time paying attention to this. Otherwise, it's just time wasted. Who wants to waste time here? We know there's something we're trying to get at, whether we're trying to flee a massacre or trying to develop some power. Either way, we don't want to waste time. So I feel like these videos, each one I have to have, say, come up upon something that is profoundly helpful. So it's not a waste of time. And I really feel this video has reached that standard. And then some. So stay with it. Keep at it. Continue to consider these things. Don't go too slowly. I didn't spend, 10 days eating that ghost pepper. I spent 10 minutes. That's still fast. So we need to really consider this advice. Really take it to heart and say, it's time to really consider this. And I know I can do it. Because again, the trauma that's coming up on this planet is quite severe. And even though every 7 billion people will view it differently, of course, it's still going to, each 7 billion people will probably all be experiencing very severe trauma. And don't kid ourselves, you know, the way, again, to be free of that is the overlay, which is simultaneously the blossoms everywhere in your universe simultaneously, and then and gently releases this perfume, this fragrance, continuously, never-ending fragrance, and then you just simply abide in that. And others will see that, and they'll say, wow, maybe I can get this to work for my universe too. Maybe I can make that decision too for my universe. And then, of course, we would say, of course you can. Absolutely you can. And it's a good time to do it. We don't need any more trauma, okay? Trauma doesn't work. Doesn't matter how intense it is. It doesn't work. It will not transmute a hypothetical into a real. It doesn't work. So why do we need more trauma? We don't. You don't need in your universe. I don't need in my universe. Nobody needs more trauma in their universe. They need to end the trauma. End the trauma. Bring on the overlay. Choose a new idea, and that'll bring on the overlay. And we're just fine-tuning this to make sure it's not going to be traumatic, because we don't want any more trauma than we can avoid, right? If we can avoid it, we don't want it. And so since this is something we feel we're in charge of, we think, well, maybe if I don't make this decision, I can avoid trauma. But again, we don't feel we're in charge of the universe, our universe. We think it's in charge of us, so we think we can't really avoid the trauma there. That is not true. But the way to avoid it, trauma, has to be choosing a new idea. Otherwise, you won't avoid it, and you won't feel that you're in charge of the universe. It'll keep manipulating you. You'll seem manipulated. All right. So this is really great. Really getting somewhere just in time, just in time. But that's good enough, isn't it? Having the right timing, just the nick of time, is good enough. All right, very great. We're going to end this video here and see how it goes from here. That's it.